Welcome to day one of 50 days of declaring God's promises. I was driving about 2 days ago, and the Lord said to me, for the next 50 days, will you decree my promises? And you know, at first it's like usually when you hear the voice and you're just like, okay. But then it was, for the next 50 days, will you decree my promises? Like it was, I'm giving you an assignment. And so here we are, day one of 50 days of decreeing God's promises. And how amazing is it that we're starting off with the first promise, which is found in Exodus chapter 14, verse 14. And I'll start at 13, where it says, but Moses said to the people, fear not, stand firm and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will show you today. For the Egyptians who you have seen today, you shall never see again. 14, the Lord shall fight for you while you hold your peace. How amazing is that, where all of a sudden, you know, the first promise that he, you know, reveals is Exodus chapter 14:14, where it says that the Lord will fight for you. All you need to do is be still. Other verses says be still. Some verses says stand in peace. And how an on-time word. Let's look at the chapter of Exodus 14. Okay. The people of God were delivered from Pharaoh. It was the moment where Pharaoh says, I'll let your people go. The people decide to leave. Moses leads the people. They get to the place where they're standing before the Red Sea. They're standing before the Red Sea. If you go on to read, God starts to harden Pharaoh's heart for a reason. Because in Exodus chapter 14, verse 10, it says, when Pharaoh drew near, the children of Israel lifted up their eyes, and indeed the Egyptians were marching after them, and they were extremely terrified. So the children of Israel cried out to the Lord. Boom. Right there, it says, the Lord orchestrated this very moment so that the people of God will begin to fear, just have this fear that will draw them to the Lord. The fear didn't display itself so that we can be ramping around chaotic, running here, running there, as if a chicken with no head, as if we don't know who the Lord is, and we're just running around with no solid ground on who Jesus is. Exodus 14:14, it says, the Lord shall fight for you while you hold still, while you hold in peace in the midst of this chaos. At this, when they were getting point to the crossing of the Red Sea, I found it amazing that they too just came out of their deliverance, and they come into this place by the Red Sea. They don't know where they're going because obviously they don't know how to cross the Red Sea. God says, you know, I'm going to release Pharaoh. He's going to release the fear. And once the releasing of the fear will happen, they will turn to me and they will begin to cry out to me. Cry out to me for help. And so when the people saw the fear, what do you think they did? They didn't cry out. They did not cry out to the Lord. Instead, they began to say, Moses, why didn't you just leave us there so that we can die, you know, and give the enemy what he wanted? So I just to think that the first decree that the Lord gives, the first promise is to say, you know, Exodus 14:14, and he says, I will fight for you. Just stand in my promise. Stand firm on the foundation of who I am. extreme fear was released so that people will turn their face. If you, we as a body of Christ already know that the body is struggling with fear, fearing the Lord, that is our number one issue. Fear of the Lord is what? The beginning of wisdom, which we are lacking. So fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Also, the reverencing of the Lord, which means that we respect, we honor the things of God. We don't take it lightly. We actually give God all the honor and glory because we know that He is sovereign, that He is holy, and that He is to be handled in that manner. But that has left the church as well. So here we are, and fear hits our nation with this virus that is supposedly not as bad as the flu, which the flu has been around longer. So fear hits, virus is spreading, everybody's going crazy, and even I can expect it from those who don't have the solid foundation, don't have the ground of Christ in them. But I am bedazzled by the ones who have been solid in the Lord and are in fear. Because even right here in Exodus, when he says, I'm releasing this, he said, not only am I going to do it, they're going to realize that I am God. So to crossing over the Red Sea. And I found that to be so encouraging that this is still God. People say God is still the God of yesterday, today, and forever. But if you don't believe that He's the God of yesterday, today, and forever, then you still don't believe that He is the God that's found in Exodus. He is the miracle working God, the supernatural God that can create miracles and supernatural deliverance. Supernatural deliverance, especially in a time like this, supernatural deliverance, supernatural healing. So here we go. And he's like, he's 19 says, the angel of God, then the angel of God, which went before the camp of Israel, moved and went behind them. Then the pillar of cloud went, moved before them, and then it stood behind them. So it came between the camps of the Egyptians. And in the camp of Israel, hello, he put a border between the enemy and his people. Then he says, there was a cloud and darkness to them, but it gave light by night. So therefore, the one did not come near and the other near the other the entire night. So there was a separation between timing because the Lord was protecting his people. Then Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and we know the rest of the story from there. The sea departs. I began thinking about this. And I'm like, what if this very moment, which many of us are very in tune to, we can tell that God is working something, obviously. There's reasoning for this. God always takes something that is bad and he will turn it out for the good. Isn't that what we prophesy? Okay. So what if the very reason fear was released was to get his people to actually come and seek his face? What if crossing the Red Sea will actually get you out of your humanity thinking and get you into a supernatural humanly thinking? The way we were supposed to be created, the way we were created. I'm not even saying supposed because he created us. So we were created with the essence and the image of God, with God in us. When God is with us, no one can be against us. And the fear that is being released has a good in it. Let me tell you about a dream I had 3 days ago now. And so the dream went like this. I was riding my bike and I just happened to look to the right. And there was a python. The python was not on his belly, but as if he was a cobra, and he would move this way, which gave him an accelerating speed to run, almost like to run. So while I'm watching, I said, where is he going? I look upward, there's a whole other bunch of pythons together, slithering around each other. I come closer. I'm allowed So here's what you know. In my dream, all the pythons didn't know I was there. So I come up on a sidewalk. I come alongside of this python, which was faster than me. He comes up, goes into where the rest of the pythons are. The pythons are in some type of slime substance within amongst each other. So they're like in this slimy goo, and they're all within each other. And I heard it's mating season. I said, no, it's not. They're not mating. Do you hear the lie? The lie came in and said, it's mating season. No, it's not. Because they weren't in mating position. And I look closer. The python that was riding next to me comes in, digs his head on the ground, and starts to do this in the ground like he's looking for something. Well, so long and behold, he finds it. And it's an egg. And he devours it. And I wake up. And I started thinking about this, and I started asking the Lord to reveal. So one, we know that whatever the enemy is doing is at an accelerating rate. Two, he knows that he doesn't have much time to devour. So he needs to speed up. Three, eggs. Eggs are new birth. Eggs can be symbolic in a lot of things in Christianity, in biblical form. You can find even scriptures where it talks about the eggs. And I just saw like the goodness of God to me. What came to me was the eggs were representing the goodness of God. And so these pythons were trying to devour the goodness of God quickly. And for them to dig in the dirt into the earth. You know, Bible talks about how we're a part of the earth, like the Lord created Adam through earth. Could pretty much mean symbolically that he is going through people and devouring the goodness of God out of them. 3 days later, we get this chaotic news with this virus. And all of a sudden, you can see the goodness of God being devoured out of the people who were actually carrying his goodness. The fear was so much bigger for them than the God that was in them. Hello. The fear became so much more bigger to them than the God that was with them. And I say it this way because God is with us. He is fighting our battles. Some days you might not see the victory as quickly as you would like it, but I am promising you at the end, you will see the victory. You will always see the victory. If you stand firm on the promises of God, you will always see his victory. Why? Because number one, it is blessed is those who believe. It's not blessed is those who are sitting in deception. Blessed is those who think that God can't do it. Blessed is those who have doubt. It says blessed are those who believe that will inherit. So blessed are those who believe. This is a season. We're seeing where everyone's belief is. We're seeing where people who say they're Christian, where their belief is. We're seeing the reality of I can be in peace and I'm watching you be chaotic. You're running from Cairo. Listen, God is God on his throne. Exodus is stating, if you would just let the Lord fight for you, if you knew that the Lord was fighting for you, you would be still. And he will deliver you. This is a moment where we have to know that the Lord is fighting for us. We need only to be still and believe in the promises of God. I love the fact that he started with Exodus 14:14. The people of God just came out of their own deliverances from coming out of Egypt. And then Pharaoh finally lets them go. And then they finally get to go off. And then all of a sudden the Lord said, wait a second here. These people don't even fear me. These people don't even reverence me. These people that say that they're my people don't even believe that I'm still God, who provided the cloud by day, who provided the fire by night, who threw the manna when there was nothing to eat, who gave them quails when they complained about no meat. Hello, it's still the same God. And he's revealing, he's like, I am still the same God. I'm still the one who delivers. I'm still the one who provides. I'm still the one who heals. If you would just stand and believe in the promises of God, you too can stand in his deliverance. You too can be healed. You too will be provided. But you got to get out of that mentality of where the Israelites were, where they wanted to go back and serve the Pharaoh. If you want to go back and serve the Pharaoh, you surely shall die. Because God is still God on his throne. And provision and your finances, your deliverance, your money, your food all comes from the one who bestows it from the throne. And that is from the Lord himself, not the government, not our president. No matter what leadership is in position, God is still the one who is still delivering. See, no matter who's in position, no matter who stands in leadership, they still have to answer to God. They still have to turn to God for answers, for wisdom, for the knowledge on how to handle situations with their people. The hardest thing a leader has to do is to turn around and ask God for questions and ponder on it and plow through it and make sure that the answers that we're receiving is right for the people of God. So see, even leaders are plowing right now, looking for answers from God to deliver his people from the extreme terror that now they're falling into. Because fear is the number one door that the devil uses to come in like a python to devour the goodness of God in man. I feel the fire of God all over this because we have to increase our faith. We do not decrease our faith in the midst of fear or in the midst of chaos of the world. We know as Bible believers that the world is going to get darker. The Bible says that Jesus will return as in the days of Noah. So what do we expect for things to turn around when we have words in the Bible that still need to be fulfilled? No, you are to stand ground. You are to stand firm on the foundations of the promises of God, believing that he is still God, who is the same yesterday, today, and forevermore, who will deliver, who will heal, who will bring provision when there is no provision, when there's no bread at your physical supermarket. God will throw down the bread from heaven, because those who are righteous shall prevail much, because the Lord hears the prayers of those who are righteous, and because of that, he will avail all provision. No matter where he does it, he will do it, because he is God and no one dictates who he is. No one can tell God how to be God. Hallelujah. Thank God for that. Glory to God that no one can tell him to be God. No one has to dictate to him, because he is still God and he's the one that's leading this ship. So Exodus 14:14, let's break off the extreme fear that was released upon this nation and let's fight back. And with power of prayer and standing firm in the promises of God, declare that over your congregation, declare that over your people, declare it over your family. They keep declaring it, because it's time to say to the world that God is still God and he will show up. When no one else can, he will provide. Exodus 14:14. The Lord is fighting for us. We only need to be still. Live your life preparing, building like Nehemiah. And the rest is up to the Lord. Pray so that our body, the people in Christ, do not lose their faith. Matthews talks about how the time will come while many will grow cold to the faith. Time will come where apostasy will rise. Time will come, and we know all the times that are going to come. So why are we so surprised that a time has come? Okay, let's read a commentary From Matthew Henry's commentary, it says, there was no way for Israel but upward. This very moment, there was no way for Israel but upward. Meaning, my only help can only come from the Lord, the only one that can deliver me. We may be in the way of a duty, following God, going after heaven, but yet there be trouble on every side. Some cry out unto the Lord. Their fear led them to pray, and that was well. But God brings us into a place where we need to be on our knees. God brings us to a place where when things like this happen, we need to go before the Lord and cry out. Because the very reason why Exodus chapter 14:14 happened was because the people of God saw the enemy coming. And when they saw Pharaoh coming with all the army, they totally forgot who God was. And they began to say, Moses, you should have just left us there to die. He would have never chased us. You should have just left us in bondage. You should have just left us in under the spirit of mammon or poverty, whatever it is. And Moses says exactly what the Lord said to him to say. Tell these people, fear not, stand firm, and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will show you today, for Egyptians who you have seen today shall never be again. Shall never be again. The Lord will fight for you. Just hold still. Here he's talking about, I allowed this to happen so I can pure the false foundation in my people. The false foundation where they said they believed in me, but they didn't. You know, that false belief that had them thinking that they were holding, that they had an anchor in their soul, but they really didn't. All they had was a rope. So this very moment, God is calling forth. Come. Pray to me. Cry to me. Because I'm still the God who provides miracles. I'm still the God who brings the manna from the wilderness. I'm still the God that still parts the Red Sea. I'm still that God that brings healing. I'm still that God that you've cried out to, that showed up in the midst of your desperate need. I am still that God. And there's no other God before me. No one dictates the things that I do because I am still God. This is a moment of getting our cracked foundation sealed with the glory of God. I'm telling you, this is a moment where God is saying, I am opening up a window so that you can reveal to yourself how false your foundation has been. Now, you have two things you can do. And it's very simple. Choose who you're going to serve. One or God. You're going to serve the false foundation and run with all this chaos and everything that's not of me. Or you're going to choose me and believe me for miracles and believe me for the provision and believe me for breakthrough and believe me for the healing. Believe in me, because blessed are those who believe in me. So the others cried out to Moses. Fear set them. Guess where? To complaining. As if God was not still able to create miracles. They fought amongst each other. They fought with their leadership. They were so angry with God for the greatest kindness he has ever done for them. The unbelief was present like ever before. And Moses said, fear not. It is always our duty and interest where we cannot get out of troubles yet to get above our fears. He's asking for them to quicken in their prayer life and to find a place where you don't silence your faith or hope. Stand still. Think not to save yourself either by fighting or flying. Wait. God has orders in this season. Observe all things around you. Compose yourself with confidence in the Lord, peaceful thoughts of the great salvation of God. That's gonna work right through you this season, this very time window we have. If God brings his people into the straight path, then he will find a way to bring them out. If God brings his people into the wilderness, he always finds a way out. He even says it. There is a river that flows through wilderness. Another commentary said, the Lord shall fight for you by commanding the winds of heaven and the waves of the sea, employing them against the enemy on our behalf. They will be unarmed and so not in a condition to fight for themselves, which we aren't. We are unarmed. We are not in a condition to fight for ourselves. As well as some have lost heart and the spirit to do it. But we shall hold on to peace. We should hold on to being still and quiet and easy in our minds. Forbid saying or doing anything. Be silent and neither express the fear and distress of the minds of the people around you. Avoid the mournful sounds. Release joy and shouts of faith. And that's pretty much what he states in his commentary. That this is the time that even Israel was full of fear. Didn't know how they were going to be delivered. Didn't know how they can do it. They were unarmed. They had no weapons. And here came a mass army with a massive amount of weapons against us. And the Lord said, be still, because I'm fighting. And you can't fight something you cannot see. So the Lord is moving, and we are to listen and heed to his command. Be still and know that the Lord is fighting for us. That is our promise for today. So I thank you for tuning in. I hope this helps encourage people. I hope it helps encourage the body of Christ. If you are a leader, be like Moses. Move forward. Take your people to cross the Red Sea. And the Lord is with us. So Father, we just thank you right now. We thank you, Lord, that you are with us, that you are fighting for us. And all we need to do is be still in your presence. So I thank you, God, for that. We thank you, God, that you are supernaturally doing something right now. What we cannot see and what we probably can't even fathom to put together that what you're doing, we are waiting on your word. We're waiting on your command, God. And until then, God, we stand firm on your promise. And so, Lord, we just thank you. God, bless your people. Bless them with protection, with the cloud going forward and the cloud going behind them, with the fire going forward and the fire going behind them. Release your angels to the hairs of salvation. And Lord, we are believing in you, and we want to trust you this season that you will deliver us. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. We'll see you tomorrow for day 2.